Hotep.
Hotep.
How's everybody feeling? In order to proceed, I have to ask first permission of the ancestors, and so I will start with asking, is it all right to proceed? Yes, thank you so much. And the first thing we're going to do in the tradition of our African people, we're going to have some libations for our brothers and sisters who lived in the motherland and gave us life. For our families who lived on this continent who gave us life. For our family members who have passed on, but whose shoulders we stand on that gives us life, we say. And for all the spirits, may they come and be a part of us this day. So that we may continue to do the good work, we say. I want something that's going to give me some way to move from point one to point two, from point A to point B. And also, I want to enjoy history. Everybody want to enjoy history? Say, I want to enjoy history.
I want to enjoy history.
And that's what we want to do. So the way I present my history classes are a little different than everybody else's. And I'm going to also ask that you participate in the class with me. I think the first thing we want to talk about is there are some fundamental things that we need as human beings. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Amen. And let me just ask Joshua, what's one thing that you need every day? One thing. Water is one. Sister Rosa, another thing you need every day? Food. God, that's what I like, food. Brother Dark, is something you need every day?
Air.
Okay, let's just take those first three and begin with the process of talking about that. What we want to say is that we know the Creator, and however you define the Creator, that's up to you. We know the Creator is going to put human beings in the best place possible for them to be the best people possible, for them to get started in the best way possible. And so that's what's going to lead us to Africa. And here's, we're going to start with the conversation about air. The first thing about air is air comes from something. And let's look at one of my scientific wizards here, Sister Tasha. Where does air come from? You don't know? Where does air come from, Anaya? The first basic place the air comes from. There's a little cheat on there. Where does air come from?
The earth.
The earth. And where does air come from in the earth?
Plants.
Plants. And what's the biggest plant that produces the most amount of air, Sister Lena?
Trees.
And that's where we want to start at, trees. When we talk about trees, we have to talk about where the greatest concentration of trees is in the planet. And the greatest concentration of trees in the planet is in the tropical rainforest. And the tropical rainforest runs around the equator. So the first thing we're going to have to do if we're going to put humans on this earth is we're going to put them somewhere where the tropical rainforest is. And we can go to our next slide. The tropical rainforest, as we see here, is a condensed area of trees that are producing oxygen. And it runs around the planet Earth. And we need to breathe every day. So we know that's going to be the first thing. So let's remember that where we're going to start at is needing air. And we can go to our next slide. And it's going to start in this tropical rainforest. This is the tropical rainforest in the mountains of the God in Uganda. And as you see, my brother here traversing the tropical rainforest. You see all these trees and you see these mountains. So that's where life is going to start. It's going to start by the trees, by the tropical rainforest. One of the things we have to remember is unfortunately in the 15th century, a group of people out of Europe decided they were no longer going to call the tropical rainforest in Africa. They had a negative name they were going to give to it, which they called it the jungle. And you and I both know if I say I'm going to send you on a vacation to the tropical rainforest, you're going to be, how soon can I go? But if I say I'm sending you to the jungle, you're going to be like, oh, whoa, wait a minute, I don't want to go to the jungle. So that was a negative connotation that we got about Africa. But the tropical rainforest is still there. It is still doing what it does, and it's still providing air for the planet. The next thing we talked about is water. And water is very, very important to us as humans. We need to drink water every day. Can I get amen?
Amen.
Because I was in a good mood when we started this class, I made sure that everybody had some water to start the class, so you didn't have to get up and get dry. So water comes from two primary sources. One is the clouds, and what's the second primary source of water?
The earth.
The earth. And what's the thing called that the water runs on the earth? What's it called? Rivers, right, rivers. And rivers have their primary growth from mountains. And the nice thing about rivers is when it comes out of the mountain, it has its own process of cleansing. And we can go to the next slide. The mountain offers the opportunity for the water to come down, go through the mountain, and when it comes out in the river, it's pure and ready to drink. Now, the nice thing about water is that you're going to need it every day. And so what we found is we had to look, we said, where is the longest river in the world? Because wherever we find the longest river in the world, that's where the good creator is going to put things to get started. And what we found is that the longest river in the world is the Nile. And the Nile happens to cross right at the equator. So now that we know the Nile River is the longest river in the world, and it's the best source of air coming out of the mountains we saw, the mountains of the moon, we see it crossing right there at the equator. So that's where the creator is going to start life at, because that's going to be the place that good things can happen. Now, water is important for you to take in to drink, right? There's something else that you want to do with water every day, too. And Sister Rosa, what do you want to do with water every day?
Bathe
in it, absolutely. One of the things we know, and one of the phrases that have come out of our African experience for the last 30,000 years is godliness and cleanliness. And the phrase goes, cleanliness is next to godliness. And we've all heard that phrase, right? And so we know that life begins, you're going to need to drink this good water, but also you're going to need to bathe. And bathing has another value to it. It makes you more pleasant to be around other people. Can I get amen?
Amen.
Because we all know if you don't bathe, you can be very unpleasant. So we talked about water. We talked about air. We're now located right there on the equator, right where the longest river in the world is, and right where that tropical rainforest is. This eliminates any conversation about any other place in the world. But we're going to continue on because there's some other things that we like to have also. We also mentioned that one of the things we like to do is eat. Everybody likes to eat. Say, I like to eat.
I like to eat.
I like to eat. One of the blessings of the Creator is there are foods that you can get that don't require what we do tend to do a lot of today, which is cooking. And those foods are fruits, vegetables, and nuts. And I have one of my favorite fruits up here, the grape. And as we know, the grape comes right off the tree. You ain't got to cook it. You ain't got to process it, unless you plan on doing some drinking of wine or making some jelly. And also, it's right there for you. You don't have to do anything to it. You don't need any technology. All you have to do is pluck it off the tree and eat it, and it's good for you. Another thing that we know about the forestry around the tropical rainforest is it also produces nuts. And nuts used to be called, the heart of the nut used to be called the meat. And that's what we can go to the next slide. The meat of the nut. And we see that nuts come off a tree. Sometimes because we have come into the modern era, we forget where nuts come from. But we do know that nuts come off trees and they open up and they fall to the ground. And you don't need any technology. You don't have to cook them, even though we like roasted peanuts. You don't have to cook them to eat them. We can go to the next slide. And nuts come in different varieties. There's some that we all enjoy, whether it's walnuts, apricots. All these kind of nuts are good for us and good for our health. And they all exist right there at the tropical rainforest, right along the Nile River. So now we've got food. Now there's something else about us that we know too, is that another source of food is we like meat, but we don't have that meat, but we do have this inclination toward fish. And that's why when you look at the African and African-American experience, we've always had fish fries as part of what we love to do. The other source of fish, of course, is the river. So when you get along the Nile, you've got the fruits, you've got the vegetables, you've got all that vegetation going on, the nuts. But also, if you get a little hungry, there's always some fish that you can go into the Nile and get the fish. Another thing that we talk about that we need is shelter, and I'm going to go right to shelter because this is an example of thatch. And thatch is a material that comes right out of the earth that you can create shelter for yourself. Let's go to the next slide. This is an example of a thatched house, which only requires that which grows out of the earth, and it requires trees, which are right there in the tropical rainforest. One of the beautiful things about being along this tropical rainforest, along the equator, right there at the Nile, being in this thatched, is that you're in a temperature base that always is in the average range of 80 degrees. So when you're in a wonderful temperature range of average age of 80 degrees, you don't have to worry about heating, you ain't got to worry about being cold, and also the beautiful thing about thatch is it allows air to filter through. It has its own natural air conditioning system. So that means that if we were there, we'd be okay, because we live in Houston, Texas, and we know when it gets above 80, we want some sort of air conditioning to condition our air so we can function. That's the nice thing about that. Let's go to the next slide. What's something else that we need every day?
Clothes.
Clothes if you're in cold climate. If you're down here in the warm climate, you don't need much clothes, right? But what was the thing that you said, sister?
Love.
And that's important. One of the things we talked about is love and touch. You need somebody to love and touch you every day. Because without it, you're going to be a cranky, mean person, and you ain't going to be happy. One of the things that we have found out as babies, we need touch. They found out that a child who was born in the hospital, they used to put them in these incubators, right? And then they found out there was a whole lot of children dying of crib death. And the reason was they wasn't getting touch. What you need as a baby when you come out is you need someone to hold you. You need someone to touch you. And that feeling of being touched is something that goes on forever and ever in your life. And we can all testify to the beauty of African people when we're in our right mind. We always greet each other with a touch, whether it's a hug, which we like to do, or the brothers who don't hug too often, we like to do handshakes, but it's still about touching. That desire, that connection of being touched is part of what we do and who we are. And it's part of our human dynamic. And so we can testify to how touch is important to us. Go ahead, sister.
I agree with everything that you said.
Another thing that happens with touch is you need love. Everybody knows they need love. Say, I need love.
I need love.
You need love in your life. You need somebody to say, we love you not because of how you look, not because of what you wear, not because of what you got, but just because of the fact you showed up on the planet. Because you're here and I'm here, I love you. And I'm gonna give you my good feelings, my good energy. And love is something that is so important that when you look at African people around the world, we are the most loving people on the planet. Because that's how we started. And we're gonna have to return to that. One of the things that we have wearing today, which was sponsored by African Diaspora Press, is we have the button, I Love Being Black. Part of how you get your own sanity back is you have to love who you are. When you look in the mirror, you have to say, I like these ears I got, I like this nose I got, I like this mouth I got, I like this hair I got, I like this skin I got, I like who I am, I love being black. That was part of what we always celebrated. When you look at African culture in the beginning, we always celebrated who we are. We always celebrated what we are. And we did other things that adorned that. One of the things that we did was we always put a little something to add to the flavor of who we are. So we always add a little jewelry. We're the first ones to create jewelry. We're the first ones to use color, not only in our hair, but in the designs that we use on our face and our ceremonies and our rituals, all of that is part of us. Another thing about loving being black is we always knew and always believed in having a good time. We believe in having a good time. And the first thing that we always use to have a good time, we talked about food. I'm gonna see who's gonna get this one. We talked about food. If you wanna have a good time, there it is, music. We believe in music. So that's how we imitated the sounds that we heard and created the drum. We believe in dance and music. We believe that music is about who we are and it's gonna make us feel good. And we can say that clearly. If you wanna clean up your house, put on some James Brown, put on some Earth, Wind & Fire, put on some Funkadelic, and you'll get your house clean. One of the things I encourage people always is take children to see live music. Not just on the radio, not just on the CD, but live music. And what they have found is that live music, when you see it in person, it creates a healing for us, and it also connects the child to those real things. One of the things I like about love and family is the fact that we created the institution of marriage. We as African people created the institution of marriage, and we held it as a ritual. And we said it's important, it's sacred, it's something not to be tampered with. In the slave captivity, we recreated our own marriage ceremony. And who can tell me what that marriage ceremony was? Who remembers it?
Jumping the broom.
And that's because love and family is important to us, and it doesn't matter where you put us, we're going to recreate family. One of the important things that African people gave to the world was a balance between man and woman. That it's not about the man being in charge or the woman being in charge, it's about balance. It's about both of them being able to have just power in the relationship. Now, you and I both know that one of the things that has been said about African women, black women, is they don't take no stuff, right? They don't take no mess, which is true. They're not supposed to, never have been, never are. One of the things we always believe in is the balance. We don't believe as African people that the way of life is somebody talking down to somebody else. We always believe we have to talk to each other. And that's the systems that we create. One of the things that the sister mentioned as we were talking is we need knowledge. And you and I may be able to see this, clear, but this says past, present, and future. And knowledge starts with the word know. Know. The first thing that we created when we created our institutions is we put a writing on the top of our institutions. And it said, man, know thyself. Man, know thyself. You have a quest for information and knowledge. Part of you always wants to develop, and your developing and nurturing comes through what they call an educational process. But this is one of the things that African people realized, and this is one of the things that we gave to the world in the beginning. We did not come as a blank slate. You've probably heard that word, that somehow we come in as a blank slate. We didn't come in as a blank slate. We knew and believed that the Creator put inside of us all the information that we would need. So information was not coming from the outside, it was always coming from the inside. What we talked about as African people is that information unfolds, that it becomes an awakening. And we proved that with the fact that when we were the first people on the earth, there was nobody telling us what to do. So that throws out that whole idea that you're a blank slate, that you gotta have somebody pouring information into you. No, African people believe in just the opposite. We believe that the information is already inside of you. We just have to awaken it. We have to bring it to consciousness. And then we have to develop it. We have to nourish it. We have to nurture it. And that's part of what we have always believed and done as African people. So that's why African people created universities, which were called mystery systems, which were called sacred schools. We created those because we believed in development, and we still do. Growing in knowledge is important. Learning how to understand the world and yourself, because inside of you is everything you need. One of the things that African people believed in is they always talked about, don't look at what you see, look at what you could be. Take what you see and develop it to what you could be. Look at not what it is, but the potential. And one of the things that African people created in the beginning of the planet was a conversation that said, you have to have a correct relationship between God, nature, and people. Then you can create heaven on earth. One of the things about knowledge, and we can go to the next slide, one of the things about knowledge is that it brings joy to you. Even as I look at Sister Tasha, who was talking to me about math, as she takes pre-calculus, as she takes it, every time that she unfolds that information inside of her, she feels better. It's true of all of us. It's important to read. Even when you've gone past the educational system, it's important to read. Get that information in, get that knowledge, grow and develop. One of the things about knowing thyself is learning about everything that's connected to you. And this is what African people said. Let's find out about everything. Let's find out about what's the best food to eat. What's going to make us feel better when we eat this food? Let's look at what this herb may do to cure us. That was information. African people were so deep that they said, not only do we want to understand everything on this planet, we want to understand things in the sky. And so they put together a calendar which was based on the moon and the sun that is still being used today, 40,000 years later. African people are some deep, serious, heavy folks. And that's why the Creator decided this is where we're going to start life. When you get into who we are, when you get into the root of who we are, when you start looking back at how everything began, you find that the tree is always a symbol of knowledge. And this is why the tree is used as a symbol of knowledge, because its roots are its strength. Its roots are its strength. When you study your roots, that allows your tree to become strong. Your roots always start with the Creator, where you come from. When you want to study a tree, you don't study from the leaves down, you study from the roots up. One interesting thing about the tree is if you cut the tree off from the roots, what will happen to that tree when you cut it off from the roots? It'll die. When you cut yourself off from your roots, you're in a death process. Not necessarily a physical death, but you're in a death process in terms of the potential of how you could live. Now, the interesting thing is once you, even though this tree may be laying on the side there, once you put it back into the earth and put it back into this environment where it can grow, what happens to the tree then? It flourishes. Life began along the equator, and that's how it flourished, and that's how it grew out from right there. The important thing too about this conversation in African history and understanding that life began in Africa is you got to see that when the Creator, and however you may name the Creator, when the Creator wanted to start life, He chose you. He chose you to put you on the face of the earth. That was not an accident. That was done intentionally, because inside of you lies the potential to bring about heaven on earth. When you, as an African, get back into your right mind, get back into your right culture, get back into your right study, get back into your right relationship, you have the ability to create heaven here on earth. All of the sacred texts that you have read from time to time will tell you whatever is true above can be true below, which is all saying that whatever is true in the heavens above can also be created here at the heavens on earth. There are some fundamental things that African people told us that we're going to need to make that happen. A positive relationship with God, a positive relationship with people, a positive relationship with nature. This is how we get back to having heaven on earth.